Hi, and thanks for rejoining me. I've entitled today's video podcast, Vision, Seeing Through the Fog. Florence Chadwick was an accomplished American swimmer, the first woman to swim the English Channel in both directions from England to France and back. At the age of 36, she attempted to swim from the coastline of California to Catalina Island. According to Wikipedia, Florence was flanked by small boats that watched for sharks and were prepared to help her if she got hurt or grew tired. After about 15 hours, a thick fog set in and she began to doubt her ability, and she told her mother, who was in one of the boats, that she didn't think she could make it. Florence swam for another full hour before asking to be pulled out, unable to see the coastline due to the fog. As she sat in the boat, she found that she had been pulled out of the water just 1 mile before reaching her final destination. That's the power of vision, or in this case, the lack of vision. The Bible tells us that people give up when they have no future hope, inspired by vision. Vision moves us to action. It keeps us in the game even when things are tough. In the absence of vision, like Florence Chadwick, we lose perspective, we become discouraged, and we quit. 2 months later, Florence tried again. This time was different. The same thick fog set in, but she made it because she kept a mental image of the shoreline in her mind as she swam. She had a vision that inspired her to keep on until she achieved her goal. Vision helped her see clearly through the fog. God birthed in Nehemiah, here in the book we're studying, a vision that kept him going, that helped him keep things in perspective. The vision was to rebuild the walls of the city and to return God's word to its rightful place of priority in the lives of his people. For a long, long time now, Nehemiah has carried a great burden for his fellow citizens, the ones that had chosen to repatriate Judea, and now he has arrived on the outskirts of that broken down city, the city of Jerusalem, and this vision for physical and spiritual reconstruction was not one that he could accomplish alone. It was one that would require him rallying people around him. And the vision, in other words, had to totally captivate the people in Jerusalem the same way it had captivated Nehemiah. How do leaders communicate vision so that it sticks with people? The answer to this question is vitally important, because if the vision we cast sticks with people, people will usually stick with the vision. In chapter 2, verses 17 and 18, we discover how Nehemiah masterfully shared his vision. Nehemiah did 6 things. The first thing he did is he defined the problem. He said, "You see the trouble we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins and its gates have been burned with fire." The problem was a devastated city that provided no security to its citizens, so he defined the problem. Secondly, he offered a solution. He encouraged them, "Come on, let's build the walls of Jerusalem." The solution was to rebuild. Third, Nehemiah demonstrated the reason for immediate action. He explained, "If we rebuild, we will no longer be in disgrace. Jerusalem, the city of God, lay in ruins, and the followers of other religions maligned God for failing to concern himself with his own reputation or with the well-being of his people. They needed to act immediately to remedy this blight." Fourth, Nehemiah told his story. Quote, he said, "I also told them about the gracious hand of my God upon me and what the king had said to me." Every vision has a backdrop that inspires people to become part of the story. Nehemiah told them about his burden for them, how he eagerly learned all he could about their condition, how he fasted and prayed for them, and how God had given him favor with the king. Fifth, Nehemiah called for action. If Nehemiah had written a vision statement, it might have read, "Rebuild the walls, restore God's word." His message got through. And after Nehemiah finished speaking to the people that he assembled, he called for action and the people responded, "Let us start rebuilding." They saw the problem, the solution, the reason, and they joined the story. And finally, number 6, though we don't see it here in these 2 verses, we see it throughout his autobiography. Nehemiah repeated the vision often. Rebuilding walls is hard work, and doing so amidst so much opposition and threat can drain vision. So to keep hope alive, Nehemiah consistently, clearly, and creatively reaffirmed the vision. Now, as you and I prepare to celebrate Royal Rangers' 50th anniversary in 2012, I, alongside every other organizational leader in Royal Rangers, am rallying the nation around a call for internal transformation intended to prepare us for another 50 plus years of fruitful ministry. Our vision is to influence more boys and young men than ever, more effectively than ever. Let's talk our way through, if you don't mind, this vision in the same way Nehemiah did. You'll recall he had five or six things that he did, and so let's walk through them. Here's the problem. Nationally, we are not establishing new outposts at the rate we should. The growing number of churches eligible to use Royal Rangers has far outpaced our ability to launch new outposts. We have huge growth potential, and that is a good problem to have, by the way. But to capture the attention of these churches and to appeal to the potential Ranger leaders and members in each, we must enter a season of transformation. Herein lies the solution. As a ministry, we must position ourselves to be more responsive to changes in our surroundings, more affordable, and more flexible. We must roll up our sleeves, determined to do whatever it takes to be more influential and effective in ministry to boys and young men than ever. Here's what will happen if we passionately pursue our vision. We will be the premier, most sought-after church ministry for the next generation of men in America, period. Royal Rangers will be affordable and practical so that every family and church can participate. As we grow, we will remain quick and responsive to learn and adapt to our changing society. Men will be eager to be trained to be mentors of young men, to train them to be Christ-like. Young men will be empowered to assume leadership of Royal Rangers, making it a boy-led, adult-facilitated ministry. Personal and spiritual growth will be fun, hands-on, and experiential. Friendship will charge our ministry atmosphere. We will reach every boy and young man by creative methods. Every Ranger will be eager to serve a God-given cause greater than self. Anyone would be proud to be associated with Royal Rangers. My fellow Ranger leaders, we can do this, but we must act now. We must rise to the occasion as Spirit-empowered leaders do in times like these. The reason is simple. Our mandate is to keep Royal Rangers a highly influential and effective mentoring ministry to future men in a rapidly changing society. Every day, young men pass into manhood without Christ. And the best time to train up a man is while he is still a boy. We all want to reach as many of them as we can. That is why we are implementing the plan described in the Seek and Save compilation of articles found on the national website. It is a plan that will make Royal Rangers relevant to a far greater number of churches, to a far greater number of men, and to a far greater number of boys. This plan will enable us to maximize our growth potential because the more churches that launch Royal Rangers, the more men that are willing to involve themselves in this great ministry, those two things combined, more churches and more men, will allow us to evangelize, equip, and empower more boys to be the next generation of Christ-like men and lifelong servant leaders. The reason this transformation time is so important is because it will lead to growth. Now here's the story behind the vision. When Brother Trask, our former general superintendent, asked me to become the national director in early 2007, I prayed, God, help Royal Rangers grow and thrive every day in every eligible church until the final trumpet sounds. You and I want the same thing, don't we? Every year, I want to look at Royal Rangers and know we have never been stronger than now. And in faith, we will know that tomorrow will be even greater. In 2062, when Royal Rangers celebrates its 100th anniversary, you and I will likely have passed off the scene, but those who follow us will be building on a legacy of growth year in and year out. Why? Because you and I determine, and those who follow us determine every single day to always influence more boys and young men than ever, more effectively than ever. We will look back at yesterday and say, we've got to do better than yesterday. And whatever transformation is necessary to make that happen, we will do it for the sake of the lost. I am so gratified that weekly we receive in our office many confirmations from across the nation that leaders are pumped about how the Lord is leading us, and each in their own way are echoing what the people told Nehemiah. Let's go for it. And I want to appeal to you. Let's bind together and let's give it our all as we serve together in the call to mentor future men. Now, there's one final lesson we learned from Nehemiah about vision, and that is that it must be repeated regularly or it loses its grip. Just as our body needs nightly rest to renew it and prepare it for a new day of labor, so our spirit needs to be reminded regularly of the vision you are pursuing in order to renew hope and reinvigorate effort. To this end, Nehemiah reminded the people of the vision to rebuild the walls and restore God's word. He did that every 28 days, approximately every month. People need to be reminded, you need to be reminded of what the vision is. This is a key Nehemiah leadership principle that leaders consistently, clearly, and creatively communicate vision. Doing so helps us see through the fog created by fear and weariness and discouragement and yes, even conflict in ministry. And of course, there's a host of other energy zappers that are common in ministry or really in any endeavor for that matter. Vision renews energy. Everything else will deplete it, but vision renews energy. It reinstates our hope. It motivates us to keep on keeping on. I want to encourage you to find ways to routinely remind yourself of our vision and to use it to encourage your fellow Ranger leaders. I don't know about you, but every time I read our vision statement, it inspires me to excellence, to be better and better in ministry than I've ever been. And that is what we want Royal Rangers to be, better and better always. Now, I'd like to close by asking you a question. What is the vision God has birthed in your heart by prayer for the boys and young men in your church and community? Can you rehearse it in your mind right now? Avoid at all costs getting caught up in the motions of running meetings and doing activities. That can get old and monotonous for you and for everyone else too. Our vision statement should challenge you to continually ask how you can influence more boys and do so more effectively. What is God speaking to you? When He conceives in you a well-defined vision that is consistent with your pastor's vision, it drives you, it excites everyone around you, and it perpetuates success. Here's how the Message paraphrases Proverbs 29:18. It says, if people can't see what God is doing, they stumble all over themselves. But when they attend to what He reveals, they are most blessed. Ask God to open your spiritual eyes to see what He is doing so you know exactly how He wants you to influence more boys and young men than ever, more effectively than ever, all across your community. Together, as we attend to what He is asking us to do, as we attend to His leading, our best days are ahead.